Is it time to preach yet? Time to preach yet? All right, let's go over that. We're going to talk about our our Bible. You got your sword with you? This is my Bible. I am what it says that I am. I have what it says that I have. I can do what it says that I can do. Today I will be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, and I am about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. Let will never be the same in Jesus' name. I want you to live and believe that. Whether you memorize it or not is not the point. If you believe that this is the ever-living Word of God, not the paper on which it is printed, not the cow skin on the outside, that's what certain religions worship is the cow, you know, but the Word of God that is recorded on the pages of these documents have the power to get in your life and change you. They are not a suggestion for how to live a better life. They are the way, the truth, and the life for how to live a better life. These pages of the Word of God have the power to direct your life. Now, ain't nobody going to tell me what to do. Oh, let the Word of God direct you with what to do. Your life will be different. Your life will be better. Your life will be challenged. Your life will be changed, and you will be better for it. Again, this is not a suggestion on how to live. It is the very words of God. And praise the Lord, we get a chance to get into it some today and learn some more as we continue to go through the 10 core values. This morning, we're talking about, in fact, as those come up here, we'll go through those 10 core values together. The delay, I understand what's happening there. She's got to stop one program and begin another because I'm so old-fashioned, I will not give up the way I do stuff. And so our newfangled program doesn't like to do that, but now we're up and running. Say them together with me. Worship passionately. Pray effectively. Instruct carefully. Connect sincerely. Relate honestly. Forgive quickly. Grow gradually. Serve tangibly. Manage wisely. And live fearlessly. Now, before I push any buttons on this thing, I'm telling this, Kim, I'm going to, in a moment, we're going to go to the next slide. It does have a video just that applies today. But what are we talking about today? Forgiving quickly. You know why we have to talk about forgiving quickly? Because last time I talked about relating honestly. And sometimes that means, therefore, it's time to forgive quickly. Let's go ahead and show that video. Yes, my wife wanted me to make sure you understand that that is not how Jesus is. That is an example of how not to be a Christian. When forgiveness has come, it is not dependent on whether or not you look the part and have the beard and all the other stuff like that. But forgiveness, and we're talking about forgiving quickly today, is freely offered by the Lord. And we should also quickly and freely forgive. Let's see. Obviously, that was a dubbed over old movie, in case you didn't know. That was not the real deal there. Maybe the voices gave it away. All right, the 10 core values are based on the Great Commission and the Great Commandment, where we should love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, love our neighbors, ourselves, and of course the Great Commission that we should go out and go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Our core values here represented love God, love others, save the planet. That's the shortened version of that. And in the middle section about loving others, we're talking about connect sincerely, relate honestly, and today, forgive quickly. So we've already seen that. So here's a little picture up here. It says under forgive quickly. If you notice some things, an eraser. It erases out the mistakes that people make. You'll notice the lady on the left side there got a rolling pin. I think rolling pins are only used to beat husbands with, not for any other reason like making and baking anything. He's bringing flowers back. Notice the picture in the top left says forgive what? It says forgive quickly, doesn't it? I noticed that it looks kind of like, when it's covered up there, it looks kind of forgive quirkly. I think that's how we forgive sometimes. We forgive quirkly, you know, kind of quirkly. We don't really forgive as the Lord leads us to forgive, as He gave example for us to give. Sometimes we forgive quirkly. So why should I forgive quickly? Great picture that I got off the internet. You've probably seen it before, and just a fantastic painting of our time. You see Jesus robed in his traditional look with a modern-looking person there, a pair of jeans and a hammer in his hand. Why? Because, and a nail in his left hand because he's just been nailing into the hands and feet of Jesus because of his sins that have harmed the Savior, of course. And so he needs forgiveness. And so he finds himself falling into the arms of the Savior, who is so willing and quick to forgive, even with the instruments of harm still in his hands. It's a great picture of forgiveness. But why should I forgive quickly? Is because it brings glory to God. It brings glory to God. God is glorified through us forgiving. He likes us to forgive, and I'll show you a little bit more about that in just a moment. First part of that is Matthew chapter 6 and verse 12 says this about forgiveness. Jesus said, and in the example prayer to us, he said, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, what kind of debts is he talking about? Money? Now, it can be. Lord, my wife and I have prayed, Lord, forgive us of our indebtedness. Forgive us for the foolishness of going into debt. Dave Ramsey fans, amen. Can I get an amen from anybody? Forgive us, am I stepping on toes? Forgive us, Lord, for the foolishness of going into financial debt. Getting awful quiet in here. Okay. Mostly, of course, we'd be talking about the foolishness of unsecured debt, not talking about whether or not you can buy a house or maybe a major purchase like a car or something, but how often we get ourselves into debt and say, oh, how are we going to get out of this? Lord, if you will forgive me. And we prayed this one time. If you will forgive us of the foolishness of getting into debt and forgive us our debts, we will forgive those who owe us money. And there was someone who owed us $1,000, and we could not wait to forgive that debt because we ourselves needed to be forgiven of much more than that. But it is not only talking about financial debt. It is talking about the debts that that are caused by the imbalance of our sin with God. And how we have sinned against God, and how we need forgiveness of those indebtedness. In fact, another gospel puts it this way, forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. It's the same concept, same idea, same Savior. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So a right relationship with God reminds us to ease up on others. That's what I get out of that. It reminds me to ease up on others. We are all ready to receive the forgiveness of God. And primarily this message is about how we need to forgive quickly because it's a core value for us. But why do we forgive quickly? Because we ourselves have been forgiven for so much. Do we have to be reminded of the sinful state in which we were before He came and saved us? I need to remind you, back before you used Christianese, terms like righteousness and forgiveness and grace and mercy and those things that are so commonly spoken in church but not so commonly used in the world, where God transformed you and made you a new creation, where God took you from where you were and the lifestyle you were living, the selfish nature with which we conducted ourselves, how quickly it is and easily it is to kind of forget those times about how much Jesus has saved us from, about how your marriage is good because you chose to begin to follow Jesus right and that made your relationships with your wife right, about how God chose to teach you to quit lying, stealing, cheating, being selfish, and those things have been rewarded in your job and with relationships with other people and how you feel about yourself. And how God taught you to quit being lazy and turned you into someone who has a good work ethic now. And so you find that your house is clean. Your bed is made this morning, isn't it, everybody? Isn't your bed made this morning? I'm meddling again. How God has changed your way of thinking. How God has turned you from out of darkness into His marvelous light. How all you wanted was a little forgiveness from your sin so you wouldn't go to hell. And He took advantage of that, didn't He? And He got meddling in your whole life, didn't He? And it wasn't enough to just forgive you of your sins. Now He wants you to go to church. And now you start going to church on Sunday morning, and now they're trying to get you to come on Wednesday night. And then they want to get you signed up for some kind of class. And then they want you to clean up your language. And then they want you to go out and visit other people and show care for somebody else. And maybe even teach a class or serve or go out into the community and hand out water bottles. And then God just gets into your heart and starts telling you how he wants to change things in your life and how things and patterns that you've been doing all very comfortably all this time, he wants to interfere with and begin to change and stop you from doing some things and start other things. He just won't quit because he loves you so much. He forgave you of the damage of the sins of our lives and has set your feet on a solid rock and sets you in a new direction. And it is a better way to do life, truly. Man, I feel like preaching. I missed a whole Sunday from preaching last week. By the way, it is good to be in the house of the Lord today. We were on the ship and there was not one church service anywhere advertised at all. We did manage to connect with some Christians later who actually set up a little service on Wednesday morning. And we went to a Wednesday morning church and took all kind of pictures to impress you guys that we even went to church on the ship and that you shouldn't miss either. But boy, did we ever miss it. And I came back this morning, and I'm worshiping, praising God, and I'm so loud. I'm like, I better shut up a little bit. That's all people are going to hear because I miss praise and worship with you. And I miss praise and worship to God. God has really done a work in my life because of forgiveness. But as we talk about forgiving others, it says, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. What does that have to do with glorifying God? You see, when my mind is on God, when my mind is on glorifying Him, then I don't want anything between me and Him. When I sin, and I still do, then I need to be forgiven quickly. And doing so causes me to come to the Lord, like 1 John 1:9 says, to confess my sin and find that He is quick to forgive my sin, faithful and just to forgive us our sins, 1 John 1:9, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so as I begin to look up to God and I begin to focus on Him and His direction, then part of that relationship with Him is making sure that I am in proper alignment with Him. That my sins are not between me and Him. That there is nothing unsaid or undone or anything that's clean and good between me and God. And so I do something like this. I say, Lord, forgive me of my debt as I forgive my debtors. And you see, you cannot be forgiven of your debt without considering the rest, which we will look at a little bit later in service. But as we begin to think about our right relationship with God, He reminds us that we need to be forgiven as we are also forgiving other people who owe us. Right relationship with God reminds us to ease up on other people that need forgiveness. It reminds me of Ephesians 4, 12, 31, and 32. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger, clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind one to another. Tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Now, I could really embarrass two out of three of my children this morning, Isaac, who's sitting on the back row, and Kimberly, who's sitting on the front row, and call them up here and make them sing the little song that Mommy taught them. Every time they could not get along with their other brothers and sisters. Now, I won't call them up because that would genuinely be cruel and unusual punishment, but it goes like this. Be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God Christ has forgiven you. Ooh, ooh, doodly-doo, Ephesians 4:32. You see why I don't want to embarrass my children? But you knew every word, didn't you, buddy? You did, and so did you, Kimberly, right? Because their mother made sure that they knew that and had to memorize that in song. So be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as Christ has forgiven you. So again, God receives glory because we remember to forgive others because we think about how God also has forgiven us first. And that brings Him glory because that excuse is what we use to give forgiveness to others. When others do us wrong and they don't deserve our forgiveness, when we don't want to give them their forgiveness, when they're not even asking for forgiveness because they think they're right, God gets no glory. But when you decide that you will forgive whether they ask for it or not, and the reason that you choose to forgive is because you yourself have been forgiven by God as God in Christ has forgiven you, then God receives glory. Now, I want to look at a couple of things up here on Ephesians 4:31. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Now, all these are the results of being offended without forgiving. Bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking need to be put away from us because they are all the results of being offended without forgiving. Do we get offended? Of course we do. Will you ever stop getting offended? Probably not. Some of you might want to try getting a little less offended as easily, but we will all be offended because in this world, Jesus said, there will be offense. But it says, so these are results of being offended without forgiving. Let me talk about some of those. Bitterness. Why would a person be bitter? Wrath, anger. Let me just start with anger. Anger is a what? Somebody's been listening. My wife alone has been listening. No, seriously. Anger is a perceived injustice. It's kind of a working definition of what anger is. It is the result of a perceived injustice. Now, it may be a real injustice, or it may be just a figment of your imagination. But whether real or imagined, when you are offended, it causes an injustice to you. You didn't let me go first. You bumped into my personal space. You interrupted me. You belittled me. You didn't recognize my value. There are a number of reasons why people are offended constantly. And that offense at how you perceive that someone else should have treated you causes or can cause anger. Can you help it if offense comes? You can't really help if offenders offend. Haters going to hate, right? So you can't help it if somebody offends. But you can help whether or not it results in anger, because anger is a perceived injustice. Now, the God who gave you a sense of justice helps you recognize an offense and the offensive nature of that and can bring a righteous indignation or anger in you. And there is such a thing as a righteous indignation. You almost can't help your emotions. You can't help getting angry. What you do with it is called wrath. Back up to the word before it. You see, being offended without immediately or quickly forgiving can cause that offense to turn into anger. If you would forgive quickly, you would not become angry. You would not ponder the injustice that was done to you. And not pondering the injustice that was done to you, you would just say, no problem, no big deal. I forgive you, no biggie. Immediately come against offense and forgive quickly to avoid anger, because if anger begins to grow, it will turn into wrath. What is wrath? Wrath is acting out on your anger. Wrath is bringing all hellfire down on somebody to tell them just what they need to know. To do anything from cause them to trip and fall to tell and scream in their face how they need to hear what you got to say, to revengeful things that maybe they don't even know you did, to anger, whatever. The wrath of man does not do the will of God. And so when we are offended, we receive the opportunity to become angry. So forgive it quickly to avoid anger, because anger will turn into wrath. And wrath afterwards results in bitterness. Why? Because despite the fact that they were offensive, despite the fact that they wouldn't ask forgiveness, despite the fact that I got angry about it righteously, despite the fact that I brought down the boom in my wrath on them, and I told them just what they needed to hear, and I got them. At the end of the day, they just won't admit you're right. At the end of the day, you can't force somebody else how they think and feel. At the end of the day, you cannot control whether someone else asks for forgiveness. You cannot control anybody outside your two ears as far as attitude. Even your children cannot be controlled. They can be contained, but they cannot be controlled. You can contain them to their room. You can contain them. Well, you don't chain up children anymore, do you? Yeah, you don't really do that. You don't really lock them in a barrel and feed them through a hole. You can contain children, but you cannot break their will. And so you become bitter. Despite my best efforts, they won't change. Despite all my prayers, God will not change them. Despite the best of my wrath, they still don't feel fully the sting of what they should feel because of how they hurt me. And look at God. Now, you'd never say this, but hiding in the back of your mind is this thought. Look at God up there letting them get away with it. Forgive it, God. They don't deserve forgiveness. They haven't asked for forgiveness. They refuse to even acknowledge that they need forgiveness. They're not suffering for their wrong. I want to wipe that smug attitude right off their face. Bitterness sets in. Bitterness is a difficult pill to swallow. It makes you ugly. Don't want to be pretty? Forgive. There was a woman in our church up in Zion, Illinois. I won't name her name just in case the word gets out. She was an older woman, silver-haired, bright blue eyes. At her age, she had earned many wrinkles on her face and was the most foul-looking, horrible, mean, witchy-looking person you've ever seen if you did something wrong. And my kids know just who I'm talking about. Do not say her name out loud. But when you were on her good side, when you told her she looked pretty, when you told her those piercing blue eyes made the white hair look so beautiful, when you thanked her for a job well done, for her faithfulness in church, or for anything she did well, she lit up like the dawn. She lit up like the morning star. She bright, the same face that looked witchy before, now looked beautiful. She was smiling, and those bright blue eyes against that white hair looked absolutely stunning. The most beautiful woman in the church. Why? Because there's a difference between bitterness and peace. Don't let bitterness become rooted in your life. The Bible says to root out the root of bitterness, to dig up the root of bitterness. Bitterness is like one of those weeds that you yank up out of your yard, and to the inexperienced, you yank that weed up, and what do you leave? The root. Snatch it up, you leave the root. And the more you do that, the bigger the roots have become, and the smaller the little things come up, and you break it off more and more, and the root never goes away. What do you have to do? You have to dig the root up to get it from coming out. In the same way, bitterness, you've taken the offense and you've planted it deep in your heart. And every time it comes out and you say something you know you shouldn't, or someone judges you for, you snap that off and you get rid of that because that doesn't look good. The fruit coming up from that bitter weed looks terrible, and you don't want anybody to know how bitter you've become about that. But the problem is your mouth keeps moving. And the surest way to see if a person has forgiven or not is to see whether or not they have to keep talking about it. If you are continuing to talk about offense that happened to you, if you cannot shut up about it, then you probably haven't forgiven. And you feel like you have. You know you have. You've said, God, I forgive them. You've done the best in your own strength to say, I forgive, I forgive, I forgive. I do the best I can. I can't truly change how I feel, but I can make the decision to just forgive. Good job. You're snapping off the thing at the root, though. You're taking away the offense of action and you're repenting of the action of unforgiveness, but you're not getting at the root. Only God can root out the root of bitterness in you. The best way to root out the root of bitterness is to not plant the seeds in the first place. Don't let offense become anger. Don't let anger become wrath. Don't let wrath give way to bitterness. Let those things go. In fact, I made a couple of notes about that. I don't want to miss any of them. It says, here a little farther. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you. I'm spending an inordinate amount of time on this verse. That's right. If I don't get to the rest, that's fine. But this is where I believe the Lord is wanting us to go right now. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, and clamor, and evil speaking come away from you. You know what clamor is? Clamor is from a Greek word. Let's see if I can get this right, Greek students. Krauge. And it means literally to cry out loud. It means, wah. Stop the wah. Stop crying about the offense. Forgive it and move on. That's literally what it means. Crying out like you're being a crybaby. Now, there may be a time to cry out. If you're in terrible pain, it's time to cry out, right? But once that's over and the forgiveness comes, then stop screaming out and whining, basically, and crying about a situation of unforgiveness. And it says, let bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you. So I looked up evil speaking. In English, it's like, well, yeah, duh, evil speaking. Don't cuss and don't say nasty things, right? Well, I looked up the word, and the word for that is the same word we get for blasphemy. And the word word in Greek is blasphemia, and it comes from two other Greek words, the first of which is blax, which means sluggish or slow. And the second part of it is fame, from which we get the word fame. And so if you put sluggish or slow and fame together, the idea of blasphemia is to be slow to call something good. Slow to call something good. When someone offends you, they become an offense. They become the picture of the enemy. They become something that is greater than the sum of their parts. They go home, they eat dinner, they go to bed. Somehow in the evening, they show up at your house in your imagination. You see their face. You talk about them because they bother you. They consume your awake time. And when you go to sleep and you close your eyes and you look up, what do you see? Not sheep, but their face. They crept into your imaginations. They've crept into your home. They've robbed you of the peace that was yours, and you just compound your anger toward them because they just won't leave you alone and won't give you a moment's peace, even in your sanctuary of your home. All the time they're at home, sawing logs, not thinking one thing about you. So who's got the problem? The person who can't let go of the bitterness. And so what happens is every time you see them in person, you are slow to give them any credit. You are sluggish to give them fame. You are slow to call anything they do good. And so what happens with unforgiveness and bitterness is if you do not forgive quickly, then anger becomes wrath. Wrath becomes bitterness. Bitterness becomes blasphemy. In other words, an unwillingness to give credit where credit is due. Now that person could not be reconciled to you if all hell broke loose, if hell froze over, if you name it, if they were the last person on earth. Nothing they do is ever good. If it is good, it must be because they have an ulterior motive. If they're being good, you just say, you just wait. If they're nice to you, it must be because they want something. If they act good, then it must be hypocritical. Blasphemy means you cannot give good credit to whom it is due. A slowness to give credit or fame. Are we guilty of blasphemy? Never thought of that before. Being slow to give glory to God? Blasphemy. Being slow to give glory to Jesus? Blasphemy. Being slow to give glory to the Holy Spirit? Real trouble. Blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. That's why Jesus said, you want to blaspheme the Son, the Father, that's fine, but these works that I do that are under the power of the Holy Spirit, don't you blaspheme that. That's from the power of the Holy Spirit. When you blaspheme what you're seeing here, you're blaspheming something and it's unforgivable because you're taking away the credit of what God is plainly doing in front of your face. And not even needing faith, but seeing it with your own eyes, you still deny the God who did it. That's why blasphemy of the Holy Spirit was so bad. They refused to give credit to the Holy Spirit for the works that Jesus was doing, obviously in front of them, the good works. And we don't blaspheme, do we? Oh no, we don't blaspheme. We just know that there's certain people in the church we just don't talk to. We don't forgive them. Oh, we've plucked off the root, the top, the root remains. We have bitterness, but we try to hide it. We don't engage in wrath or open anger anymore, but it burns below the surface as a seething bitterness. And we continue to be slow to give any credit to any attempts on their part to do anything right. And we continue to be suspicious of every good thing they do, because you know, don't you? You know. You know what others cannot see. That person may be good to others, and they may be duped into thinking that's a good person, but not you. You know better. Ouch. Man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. Are you God? No. That leaves you and me in the situation of being unable to judge the motives of the heart of someone else. Yet we do it anyway. And we judge that they are not good. And we judge to be slow to give credit and blaspheme not only them, but our God. Thank God he said all blasphemy against God and the Son would be forgiven. Gee, if I spent too long on that one. All right. So let all bitterness, wrath, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind one to another instead, tenderhearted instead, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Here's the rest of Matthew 6 and verse 13. It says, and do not lead us, the rest of the Lord's Prayer, do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. A couple of verses back, we had the beginning of that Lord's Prayer where it says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So we are receiving forgiveness because we are forgiving others, and that's part of our plan to glorify God. And just a few verses later in that same prayer, he says, and it says, and do not lead us into temptation. Now, does God lead us into temptation? Well, the book of James chapter 1 verse 13 says, don't let any man say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. Because God does not tempt anyone with evil, neither does is not tempted himself with evil, neither does he tempt anyone else with evil. But you see, that word for temptation can be trials, or what you classically think of as temptation. It can be either one. And here it says, do not lead us into temptation. Well, you don't have to pray, Lord, don't lead me into temptation. Be sure Jesus will not lead you to tempt you to do evil. But will he allow you to be tempted by the tempter? I bet the answer is yes. Let's read on. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Who is the evil one? The devil. You ever notice how devil is spelled? De-evil. the evil one. You learned something in church today. The evil one is the devil. Some people think talking about a devil makes you smirk. You don't really believe in a real devil, do you? Call him the evil one. Sounds better, kind of Darth Vader-ish, whatever. When the evil one does his job, he tests you. And how you do with that test can bring glory to God. And so God the Father will allow you to be tempted by the evil one to see what you're made of. He himself does not tempt you with evil, will not tempt you to do wrong. But he stands back after a while and says, let's see what you've learned. He's given you the strength, he's given you the ability, and watches you to see how you're doing. And so we say, Lord, lead us not again into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one who does that tempting. Why? Because yours is the kingdom, yours is the power, yours is the glory forever. Do not lead us into the temptation. What temptation is he talking about? Let's back up to the beginning of the prayer. Oops, I went the wrong way. Boom, boom, boom. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Is the temptation of the evil one to not get you to pray this prayer? Forgive us our debts while we are forgiving our brother. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one whose job is to tempt us to not forgive. And in so doing, I will be bringing you glory and power and praise to your name. Amen. Maybe you never looked at the Lord's Prayer like that before. All right, why should I forgive quickly? Because it also builds relationships. I'll spend a little less time on this part, so don't panic. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, where is the altar? Well, in the Old Testament, it was a place of sacrifice where the priest would take the lamb that you brought, slit its throat, pour out the blood, and let that be a burnt sacrifice for your sins. It was symbolic of the Lamb of God, Jesus, who would later be sacrificed on a cross and would give his blood for your forgiveness. It was a place of worship, in other words. It was a place to come and give God glory and praise and homage. And so the altar, whether it be what we call these steps up here, which sometimes we say come to the altar and make a decision for God, or whether in the Old Testament they came to a place of sacrifice, it was always a place of sacrificing our own desires for the will of God. And so he talks about the sacrifice of praise. The fruit of our lips giving praise unto our God is a sacrifice of praise. And so when we come to the altar to bring praise to God, whether Old Testament, New Testament, at church at a carpet-edged steps, or whether it be in your car giving praise to God in your worshipful singing self, when you come to bring praise to God, and there remember that your brother is offended against you, not the other way around. But your brother is offended against you. Leave your gift there. In other words, don't give up on praising God. Leave it temporarily to come back to. And go your way. Whew. Got off easy on that one. Oh, first be reconciled to your brother. Then come and offer your gift. Man, he doesn't make it easy, does he? You know what would have been easier? Is to forgive quickly to begin with. Because if we don't forgive, then we turn into anger. And anger turns into wrath. And wrath turns into bitterness. And bitterness turns into this ugly thing of unforgiveness. And now we have to go approach that person who still isn't asking for forgiveness, who still has that smug, nasty look on their face. And we have to now humble ourselves as if we should. And try to make peace with them before I can come back and praise the Lord. Why is that fair? I got a clue for you. It's not. Did anybody tell you that forgiveness was going to be fair? If they did, they lied to you. Is it fair that Jesus forgave you? No. then it's not going to be fair when you forgive others. Ding! It's not going to be fair when you forgive others. The good news is you have a choice. You ready for this great choice? Forgive quickly, or don't forgive quickly, but forgive later. If you forgive quickly, you avoid this scenario. And you also avoid this scenario. If you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all, as if he could. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants. Now it's this way instead of this way. Who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, Pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down on his face, our feet, and begged him, saying, Have patience, and I will pay you all, as if he could. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. And then the master, after he had called him, said to him, You wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. You know what I wanted to say was, aren't you glad that God isn't like that? Oh, wait. God is like that. So my heavenly Father will also do to you if each of you from his heart does not dig out the root of unforgiveness and forgive his neighbor or his brother his trespasses. So I talked about a choice we had there. Obviously, that's out of all the time we got. The choice, you can forgive quickly. You can forgive when you want to have a right relationship with God in praise and prayer. A little later, a little harder, a little more embarrassing to have to pick up that phone, find that person in person. Not to say, okay, fine, God, I forgive him in my heart. What? Now I have to go find them? Wouldn't it be better to forgive them quickly than to have to go find them later? Because that's what he requires. Go to them, leave it there, and go to them and forgive them. That doesn't sound fun. And then come back and worship. And that is the high standard to which you as a Christian are called. It's not easy being a Christian. He calls you out of the doldrums into a higher plane. He calls you to do the hard thing. If John F. Kennedy can call his nation to do the things that are hard just because they're hard, and people by the droves follow in those footsteps inspired by those words, can we not be inspired by the words of Jesus who calls us to do the hard things? Can we not say, I will be that generation. I will be the one who forgives. And if I do not forgive quickly, I will do the hard thing, man up, or woman up, and be the one who goes to that person, obeying Jesus and making it right with them. Because those are the only real two choices. Because the last choice is to be unforgiving and to not receive forgiveness from that. I'm not sure where that fits in your theology, but once saved, always saved. But I know one thing. Jesus was real clear about this issue. That is not a choice. Not forgiving is not a choice. We're out of time, so let's respond. Now, here's what I would love to do. Y'all all come and worship at the altar. Get April up here singing, which I'm not asking you to do, April. And let's be praising and worshiping, and I will set the trap for you. Remember, the bait of Satan is to take the bait of offense And then after we're up here praising and worshiping God, we will remember someone who has offense against us, that thinks there's something wrong with us. Now, if you're offended at somebody else, just forgive it and move on. But if there's something between you and somebody else you need to go to, then the proper response is to leave this altar and go find them. Today, preferably, in the service, preferably, if necessary, out those doors, find them and find forgiveness. And then go back and worship God, no matter what their attitude is, by the way. You don't have to make them. And don't ever be someone who's not forgiving at all. So what's the proper response today? Forgive quickly for the new stuff. For the older stuff, forgive quickly. For the bitter stuff, dig quick. Forgive quick and kill it with the shovel. And Drano, that works. Kill it. Kill that root of bitterness. Root it out. Forgive and receive a beautiful smile. And the forgiveness of God. Stand, if you would, for the closing. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would help us to go from this place responding correctly to the Word of God. Help us to forgive quickly for new offenses. Help us, Lord, to root out bitterness that we have allowed in our hearts. And help us to forgive that quickly. Rooting it out. Not finding a need to continue to talk about a person, but to go to them if we need to. Tell them we forgive and root out that bitterness. Let us be people who rise to the occasion of doing the hard things for the sake of the kingdom of God. And let us never make a foolish mistake of refusing to forgive. Lord, we try to forgive. Some of us, Lord, it's no joking matter. It's been some fun in this message, but it's been no joking matter, Lord, for a lot of people in this place who have been so deeply hurt and offended by others that it is no joking matter. And they have tried to forgive, and they have tried to forgive, and they have tried to forgive. And they're trying, God. They're not refusing to forgive. They're not in danger of losing their own forgiveness because they're trying. They're not refusing. But because of that trying and failing, Lord, the root's getting bigger, and we're just snapping off the top of the plant. God, would you help us, even if it needs some counseling, another set of ears, to dig into our hearts, dig up that bitterness, expose it, condemn it, forgive it, and throw it out on the pile to be burned. Lord, help us to learn to forgive and to forgive quickly as Jesus did. And we give you glory because you have forgiven us. And we thank you for that forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen.